Good morning, it's now 10 o'clock. A very warm welcome to all of you who have joined us this morning. So we will be talking about exam preparation. I just want to share the program with you and then also just talk about some basic principles as we are together this morning. So my name is Lisa Daisel. I'm from the Unisa Directorate for Counselling and Career Development. And with me, I also have my colleague, Mr. Pignani, also from the Directorate. He will introduce himself shortly. So our program this morning, we will be asking Ms. Putelezi to share with us some information about exam preparation. Then Mr. Pignani will talk about exam integrity. Ms. Nalushi about exam anxiety. And then we've also invited a colleague to talk about the technical skills that you need in order to complete your exams. We will be having a Q&A session sometime after the presentations to answer your questions. But as you are listening to the presentation, please feel free to post any questions or comments you have in the chat on Microsoft Teams. You might have noticed that your microphone and your camera is off at this stage, but during the Q&A session, we will be able to unmute you and you will be able to ask your questions live. We just ask that in the chat, please don't share any personal information, that is things like your email address, your private email address and your telephone number. We will be, or we are recording the session, and you will receive a notification in Microsoft Teams once the meeting is over that you are able then to watch the recording if you're not able to stay for the whole session. So on that note, I'm just going to hand over to Ms. Putelezi, and she will be sharing with us the exam preparation section of our program. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Ms. Daisel. Good morning, everybody. Let me kindly share my presentation and then we shall commence. Okay, thank you. My name is Sinetlanhla Buthelezi. I am a BSc Honours Honours in Geography holder. I am a current MSc candidate, and I am also a student mentor for the academic year 2024, and I'll be your presenter today presenting exam preparations. Our overview, I'll be explaining what is examination. I'll also share with you some exam preparation tips. And then we'll also dive in into the types of examinations that we have, which are your multiple choice questions, short answer questions, essay questions, case studies, portfolios, and problem or calculation exams. Okay, and then explaining now to you guys what is an examination. So an examination is a common method of an educational assessment intended to measure one's knowledge, skills, ability in a particular subject. As you can see, I have referenced where I got this this definition, and moving right along, and then we are now diving into exam preparation tips. So the first thing that you guys have to do is to create a timetable, or not create per se, but to like print it so that you can have something visible to remind yourselves of the module code, the time, and the type of exam that you'll be writing. So you can do this by, as I've mentioned, you can print these hard copies, or you can just have it there by your laptops in soft copies. You can also like set up calendar reminders, maybe like for the day before the exams and maybe like an hour before your exams, because believe me, I have missed an exam before, I was supposed to write it at 9:30, and then somehow, some way, with all the exam pressure and the preparation, I went to the venue at 11:30. So you can imagine the embarrassment that was happening at that point. So it's very important that you do have all this information at hand. And then you need to know your exam format, because exams, they vary in style. They also vary in rigor and requirements. So as I've already mentioned, we have some others will be writing portfolios, some others will be writing essay type questions, some others will be doing multiple choice questions. And then you need to find a revision style that suits you. We talked about this on our last workshops when we are talking about study skills. It's up to you. You know, I think by now you know the type of style that goes well with you when you are studying. Are you the person who prefers to like study in a library in a quiet place, or you like maybe seeing nature while you are studying, or you just study in your house in a little corner there? So you need to find a revision style that suits you. And then what you need to do, you need to rewrite and reread your notes with the hope that you guys, when you were studying, you were doing notes using your course material. So this will help you to identify all your problem area and address them before you go and sit for that exam. What you also need to do, you also need to verbalize what you have studied. So how do we do this? You can do this by telling someone, or you can teach the content to someone else, or you can even practice in your own house in the mirror there, just to like find out what you can remember and so forth. I was talking about verbalizing what you have studied. So I said you need to tell or teach the content to someone. You can do this by also practicing in front of the mirror in your own house, just so that you can recall what you have learned so far. And then maybe if you have problems here and there, and then you can just learn on those areas. Is the next slide visible? And then you need to practice the exams. So you can do this by preparing your own exams, your own practice, your mock-up exams, or you can do this by doing flashcards and then prepare questions and then you answer just to check what you know. What is also important is that you peruse past exam papers. This will help you familiarize yourself with the layout. So the layout is basically the structure of your exams and the type of questions that are going to be asked. And then this will also help you to practice time management, because we know that exams are time-based. And then these are the type of exams. I've already shared this on my overview. And then we're going to dive into multiple choice questions. So what is a multiple choice question? It's usually called an MCQ, short for multiple choice questions. So this is a form of an objective assessment in which respondents refers to you guys, you the student. So it is a form of an objective assessment in which respondents are asked to select only the correct answer from multiple choices offered as a list. And then it requires respondents to have thorough content knowledge to be able to achieve or choose the correct answer. So with multiple questions, there's usually this myth that is attached to it, that just because it's an MCQ, you're gonna pick and choose. You don't need to prepare, you don't need to study. That cannot be further from the truth. You do need to prepare, and of course you do need to study so that you can be able to retrieve that knowledge or information, and then you choose the correct answer. So now I'm going to be sharing some strategies on answering MCQs. The first one, you need to manage your time. So you look at the number of questions and divide your time accordingly. So usually you have like 20, maybe two marks, and then it's like 100 marks. So you can divide this by maybe you're gonna say I'll be spending 1 minute for each question so that you'll be able to finish your paper in time. And then you need to read the questions carefully. So you look for trick or absolute words to avoid choosing the wrong answer, such as these absolute words are your nevers, not, lack, sometimes and always. For example, maybe if a question says which of the following is never, so already you know, Buti, the word never is like a trick or an absolute word, and then present without respiratory symptoms. So you need to look out for those words. And then you need to answer the questions without looking at the options. So before you even attempt to look at the options given, you should try to at least read the question and then try and answer it before you actually look for choices. This is this may be like you underline and then you underline or you circle the keywords while doing this. And then you need to read every option. So after you have tried to answer the question without looking, and maybe you've underlined and circled those keywords, and maybe you think you know the answer, the next step is for you to read every option. This is very important because you read all the options because there may be multiple correct answers. Even if answer A appears to be correct, do not skip. You shouldn't skip the remaining choices because sometimes you might think, okay, answer A is the correct answer, only to find that maybe D is the best correct answer. Moving right along, then you also need to read the question carefully again. This time you'll be looking for incorrect words to avoid choosing the correct answer. So for example, the question might be, according to the passage, which of these makes the best pet? So your keyword here would be the best pet. Okay, so and then you have your options. Your option A is the goldfish. Is it a dog? Is it a snake? Is it a chicken? So with the dog, we know the dog is a good pet, but if you own maybe like a pit bull, it might be a problem to other people and in the communities, because you know pit bull of eating people and stuff like that. And then a snake, well, some people do keep it as a pet, but yeah, it's usually not like advisable because they are dangerous and stuff. And then a chicken also can be a pet, but when you're hungry, yeah, no, you might need to eat that chicken. So the best answer here, or the best pet, would be the goldfish. And then right. If all fails, and you have tried all these strategies, and then you should do the guessing games. So you use the process of elimination by eliminating answers you know are incorrect to increase your chances. Rather than looking for the correct answer, better look for incorrect answers. Rather than looking for the correct answer, you better look for the incorrect ones. If you do not know the answer, it is better to guess than leave a question blank. Please, guys, never leave a question unanswered when you are doing MCQs. You rather guess by eliminating, or like use the previous strategies to eliminate all the incorrect answers. And then rather than looking for the correct one, so that you don't leave any answers, any question unanswered. And then we are done with our MCQ. So we'll be doing, we are moving on to our main topic with common question types. So here, after MCQs, it's going to be essays. But before we dive into essays, portfolios, and case studies and short answer questions, I wanted to first focus you guys on the common question types. How do you identify this when you are writing your exams? So when approaching questions that require focused written answers, like short answer questions, essay, case studies, those that requires like a sentence or two or a paragraph. So it is important to identify what kind of response is expected. That is what is being asked of you and what information you are required to include. So these are the types of these are the types that you can come across while writing your exams. When they say the first one would be identify. So identify falls under the essay type, ask for short, direct answers, usually does not require a fully developed response. So this one falls under short answer questions. Short answer questions would require like one or two a sentence. And then the questions to consider, what is this idea or concept? Like maybe they are saying, explain according to your understanding what is global warming, or they can just say, what does the word waste management means? Okay, so, and then the keywords will be your list. You summarize, you enumerate, you describe, you define, you state. And then another word, the command word would be explain. So this type of essay should be fully thought out and developed in as much details as we have time for. So here would be, and then the questions to consider is, why is this the case? So why is this thing the way it is? And then what are the main points? And then your keywords to look out for is discuss, analyze, explain, and illustrate. And then moving right along, we also have compare. To compare, okay, I think we know what is to compare, is to like compare two things with each other. We are comparing with our similarities or differences. So this type of essay requires an analysis in essay form. So this, you might come across this when you are doing your essay questions and your case studies exams in your exams. So which emphasize similarities and differences and connections between these ideas or concepts. Like I've already said, question to consider, what are the similarities and differences you, and then the keywords would be contrast or relate and compare. And then the other one is argue. This type of essay involves describing acceptable criteria and defending a judgment on the idea, issue, or a question involved. So here your questions to consider would be, why is this correct or why is this true? So here you have to justify, you have to prove. If you believe that climate change is real, then explain to us, or you prove to us why you believe so. So this you must also come across when you're writing your case studies, your essay question in your exams. And then the last one, the last command word would be to assess. Assess also means to investigate. So this type of essay involves describing acceptable criteria and defending a judgment on the idea, issue, or question involved. Questions to consider here would be, what does this mean? Why is it important? What are the strengths? What are the weaknesses? And then the key words would be to criticize, to evaluate, to interpret, to review, to critique. So here, for example, my research is based on waste management. So what I'm doing is I'm assessing. I want to assess if waste awareness programs are implemented in school as per as per the Constitution. So here I am criticizing, I am evaluating, and I am reviewing this. So that's how you would go about. And then we now carry on with the types of exams, which are now short answer questions. And then I have explained what is a short answer question. So, and then short answer questions required respondents to construct a concise and focused written answer to a question using complete sentences that may be factual, interpretative, or a combination of the two. For example, this would include, maybe they would say, define a certain concept, and then they would say, give the characteristic or benefit or impact. Maybe let's say impact of improper waste management. So those are your short answer questions. And then short answer questions have different types of cognitive levels. So you might find it's easy, you might find average, and then you might find difficult. So these are aimed at assessing a respondent's ability to integrate what you have learned in the module and to apply your knowledge. Like I've said, they might say, define a term, and then they might say, maybe define it in your own understanding. So there you are integrating what your ability of what you have learned in the module, and you are applying your knowledge. And then we are focusing on strategies on how to answer short answer questions. And then you, firstly, this is standard, guys. For every exams, you have to read these instructions. You have to read the question paper before you attempt to answering it. So again, you're gonna read the instructions carefully. You take note of how many questions you need to answer. And then you take notes of mark allocations, and then you're gonna divide time accordingly, which comes to our next point. You need to read all the questions before you begin writing. This will help you divide time accordingly and consider the mark distribution. And then you must pay close attention to the wording of the question. So as I've already mentioned, the command words, you have to pay attention. So you must pay attention to the wording. This will help you understand and know what you are being asked to do and how you are required to do it. For example, a question may be two parts. So mostly what happens here, student, they usually focus on the first part. If a question is a two part, and then they just disregard the second part, which results to getting maybe the question was for 5 marks, and then you are required to define, and defining maybe it's two marks allocation, and then the 3 marks it's for you have to describe the impact or something on the benefits of having associated with that certain term. So usually what happens is that student would just focus on defining, and then they're not going to do the second part. Now you are, that results to you getting lower marks. So this will also assist you to avoid generalizing about the question. So this is also important, in as much as you must focus and pay attention to the wording of the question. Also, please do not include information that is not required. Let the question guide you on what you need to do, on what you are required to do. And then you need to recap. So you need to try and leave enough time to read over your answers at the end of the exam to make sure each response includes the required component. This is another important aspect when you're writing your exams. You write, and then after, try and proofread to see that you have attended to all questions and you've done everything that was required of you. And then you let mark allocation guide the length of your answer. Again, this is another very important point, because sometimes when you are in the zone, we tend to like write and then we end up like generalizing, which goes back to the point I just mentioned. You are in the zone now, you are feeling yourself, and then you end up answering something that was not done, was not asked, and then like you are taking longer, and then you are, your time, it's like getting shorter for you, and then now you are unable to answer the following question. So let the mark allocation guide the length of your answer. How long your answer is will depend on marks allocation for the question, e.g. you are required to define, which is often 2 marks, as I've just mentioned, and then therefore you are required to write 1 or 2 sentences. And then whereas if you were required to maybe write impact of global warming, it would be like 5 marks and then, or 10 marks, and then you are required to write like 1 paragraph, which is very 5 to 6 sentences, or you can write maybe like 4 points on the impact of climate of global warming, you see. And now we are moving on to essay exams. What is an essay? An essay question requires respondents to provide an argument and supporting evidence, which comes from knowledge gained from modules, reading, seminars, discussions, and assignment. Again, when you are writing these type of exams, you are going to be using the information that you were reading throughout the time. And then obviously this is from your course material, your seminars, maybe your discussions in your platforms, and then from your assignments. And then strategies on answering essays: you read through your questions. Standard, you use the first 5 to 10 minutes of the exam to write down the relevant point you remember on all essays question you are going to answer. So here, the first thing that you do, you read, and then you're like, okay, this one I remember. You make notes there, I remember this one, and then you write the related or relevant topics on that question, so that you'll be able to come to the next point that I'm just gonna talk about. This will help you to be able to start with the easiest questions. So when you have done reading, you'll be able to identify with which are the questions that you know, and then which are the questions that you find like a little bit difficult, or maybe you didn't cover the content while you were studying. So you must start with the easiest questions, and you must leave the hardest until last. So when you're leaving the hardest until last, that's where your general knowledge will come in. Like you have to like write, you do not leave the question unanswered, but you are required to maybe like apply your common knowledge. You can generalize. Yeah, then maybe you can, if maybe the question is like 10 marks, maybe you can get 5 marks on that question instead of just leaving that question unanswered, and then you get a 0. So you also familiarize yourself with the terminologies used. So like I said, it's important to peruse past papers. Therefore, you can know the structure, and then you know how to identify keywords, and then you can know the terminologies that are used there. And then you must apply the golden rule. So there's a golden rule when you are writing essay exams, guys. It's standard for every paragraph, argument, provide supporting evidence or include examples. And then supporting evidence include expert authors on that specific topic. Referencing only applies when you use a book or a journal. So when you are writing an essay, and maybe they give you maybe three topics, and then they say choose one, and then you are required to write. You have to, the first thing you do, you always define the term, always define the term, and then You maybe write the characteristics of the thing, the impact, the effect on that certain topic. And then you always provide, now that's where you're going to provide examples and supporting evidence from authors, like maybe so and so said climate change happens because of 1, 2, and 3, and 4. And then you are going to reference. But usually, when you're writing essays, exams, you are not required to reference, because it is like an essay exam, so you are not required to reference. But otherwise, if you were to be writing in portfolio, which we're gonna dive in after, then you will be required to reference your work. So, and then you must, okay, yes. And then you need to develop an argument from the question and include it in your introduction. So now we are focusing, and then the question would be, how do the goals of liberals and socialist feminism differ? So this is what you do when you are giving a question, like example, how do goals of liberal and socialist feminism differ? So you always start your argument from the question. So what you would do, you would say the goals of liberals and socialist feminism differ in three ways. These include, you name them, and then after you go off and start from with the first one, and then you explain the first one, and then you'd go on to explaining the second one, and you would go on to explaining the third one. And then moving right along, you need to follow the basic essay structure. After following the basic golden rule of always including sources and supporting evidence, you also need to follow the basic essay structure, which is always introduction, your body, and conclusion. Because, and then the introduction, the aim here is to introduce the subject, explain how you understand the question. As I've said, it's usually always you have to start by defining the term, providing a brief historical or a personal context. Maybe they say they gave you a topic based on waste management. So the first thing you do is to explain what is waste management from a recognized author, and then maybe you can write it in your own understanding, and then now you can provide maybe a brief history of waste management, maybe the processes of waste management, what waste management entails, and then also you can also put in your personal context. So you need to keep the introduction short and straight to the point. So it's usually 1 or 2 paragraphs for essays, and then 1 or 2 pages for a dissertation, if you were to be writing a dissertation. So, and then we go to the main body. The main body is where you provide detailed thoughts, attitude, philosophies, or viewpoints from different authors. So you have explained what is waste management, and then maybe what are the causes of improper waste management, and then now you have to dive in more, like you're giving more details, and then you are just sharing details, thoughts from different authors. So you are voicing your opinions, and then you are supporting your views using researched evidence or example taken from other writers. That's what you do on the main body. When you are pursuing your master's and you're at the level or your honors, this is what we usually call a literature review. So a literature review is basically you are reviewing what has been done based on that topic. So this is what you do when you're writing the main body. And then on your conclusion, you provide your closing remarks. You draw a conclusion based on your argument or comparing viewpoints. So basically, you summarize here. You just summarize, and then you give your own remarks, your closing remarks. Okay, maybe just say, based on what has been done previously, so these are the recommendations or these are the closing remarks. So this is what you do. And then a conclusion is also a good place to mention recommendations, as I've said, that you are going to recommend based on what you find based on your certain topic. And then maybe you can identify further research questions recognized, but do not come within the scope. You can also like add, maybe if you find something else and then which wasn't mentioned by the previous authors, and then you recognize that certain aspect that is missing, and then you can comment and edit there on your conclusions. And then you do your reference list, always include the sources of information you have used in your write-up. Again, as I've said, if you are doing your exam essay, you are not required to reference because of time constraints. But if you are doing case studies and if you are doing take home or portfolios, then you are required to always reference your work. And then moving right along, we are moving to case studies or scenarios. And then now, what is a case study or a scenario? Scenario questions required respondents to integrate key concepts of the module, apply theories to a practical context, and demonstrate the ability to analyze and evaluate. So here it's often long answers. So you'd find a question would be like 25 marks. So you know if it's for 25 marks, then you need to write. Again, you are gonna apply the basic structure of an essay. You start with your, based on your topic, you wanna start with the introduction, and you're gonna include your body, and you are gonna have a conclusion. So strategies here is to understand the task. As I've already mentioned, it's always standard to read your instruction and interpret the question carefully. Look for instruction verbs. Instruction verbs are those command words that I told you. You identify, you explain, you argue, you compare. Those common words that are used when you are focusing on answers that need concise and focused written sentences. So you look for instruction verbs, and then you make sure you understand what they are asking you to do. E.g., you list all issues related to climate change. So our command word here is to list. So you basically just have to outline all issues that are related to climate change. And then you have to read the case. You read the case study, underline or note words or numbers that relate to the module concept or indicate a particular problem. Remember, usually when you are doing case studies, it's usually based on a real-time phenomena. So you have to read the case study, and then you have to underline and note those words that indicate a particular kind of problem. That particular kind of problem usually requires solving. So yeah. And then you have to envision the scenario and module context integration. Again, because this is something that you are doing throughout the year, so you have to find ways to integrate and mention the issues from the scenarios and also related to the course material, because that would be something, that would be a topic that you have read or you have come across in your course material, and then now you are applying that knowledge from the course material with this real life issue that you have been given from a case study scenario. And then you have to ensure you are following command instructions. we've talking about this. Now you have to check again that you are following the command. If the question asks you to make recommendations, you have to check again if you have included this. Like I've said, you must try to recap after your exam just to see if you have attended to all the questions and you have answered all the questions as you are required to do so. So you also have to develop and evaluate solutions. Again, I've also said this, usually case studies, they relate to real life problems that do need solutions. So you must identify possible solutions to the scenario, you assess advantages and disadvantages, you consider how these theories covered support or nullify your solutions, and you make the recommendations accordingly. And then pay attention to mark allocation. So basically it's when you are writing your exam, like it's basically the same format. You read through, you underline keywords, and you pay attention to mark allocation, so that you can divide your time accordingly. And then you write, and then you apply knowledge from the content that you have read, and then you have to recap just to browse and proofread your work after. So again, if a scenario is like 20 marks, you have to include at least 5 different points about 4 different concepts. So based on the concepts that you were asked about, maybe you are asked about environmental legislations, then you'll focus on your different types of legislations that are there for the environment. And then moving right along to portfolios or open books exams. So what is a take home or an open book exam? These ones, they allow respondents to have access to all the resources you can think of. We are talking hard copies, soft copies, course material. You can use the internet. You can also use the calculators during the exam. And then it's usually written outside of a supervised exam. So this one, obviously, it is a take home. So it's usually referred to you writing it at home in your own time. The emphasis on open books exams is on conceptual understanding and application of knowledge, rather than just having the ability to recall facts from your course material. So here, it's not only about maybe let's say it's compared to short short answer question where you are required to remember the definition of climate change. Here you do not only have to recall the definition of climate change, but you must go like deeper, explain in details, give your own context to the understanding of the word. So that's why they are saying the emphasis is on conceptual understanding and application of knowledge, rather than having the ability just to remember what was said in your course material. And then students are usually allocated a submission date. For example, it must be 2 weeks, 1 week. And then this exam tends to be mark strict. Because you are writing it outside of a supervised room, you are writing it in the comfort of your home. So you are the marks, when they do marking, the marking is very strict. So you do make sure that you are precise, and then you go in details when you're explaining your concepts and the whatnot. So therefore, this is because you had time to write compelling and well-structured work. So your work must be well-structured. And then it must be compelling, accompanied by facts, examples, evidence, references, also include your recommendations, your similarities and differences from past authors who have talked about that certain concept or topic. And then strategies, analyze the question. You are required to understand the question, and then you apply an effective system of organizing your resources so that you can easily find relevant information quickly. Remember now, because now this is a take home, you have to read the question, and then after you know what you are required, and then you start on collecting your resources that you're gonna use. Find resources that you're gonna use so that you can easily find the relevant information, and then you can answer quickly and then submit on time. And then you must plan your responses and use your notes. Remember, as you're studying throughout the year, you were making notes, so you can use those notes, and then you can plan your responses, which require detailed responses, and therefore you are ought to demonstrate your knowledge and then understanding of the subject, as well as your ability to find and apply. So you have to find resources, and then you apply that information, and then you demonstrate your knowledge from the course material and the knowledge that you find from the resources that you used. So it is quite hectic, and it needs you to be disciplined and focused, and please ensure that you submit on time, because if you do not submit on time, then you are in trouble. And then you have to use practical example to illustrate your point, because a portfolio open book, they require complex responses. Therefore, you are expected to use reason and evidence. So you cannot just make up information or just write, only voice your opinion, in as much as you need to voice your own opinions, but you do need to support with evidence, examples, as I've mentioned, from past authors that have done work on a similar topic that you are doing. And then you need to apply your organizational skills. You have to organize and detail your workload so you have time to focus on answering your questions. So this one is actually right after reading your questions, and then you read your questions, and then you know now what resources to look out for, and then you go and look for those resources, you find them, and then you apply your organizational skills, where you organize that. Okay, if it's 2 weeks, for the first 3 days I'll be focusing on a certain topic, and then on the following week I'll be focusing on this section. So this is where your organizational skills come in. And then you have to revise your work. You definitely have to revise it, since you'll be writing at home. You cannot submit the first draft. So you have to proofread. You have to proofread your work. I'm not sure if you're allowed to give it to someone else to proofread it for you, because sometimes when you are working on a paper yourself and then you've been reading it so much, you sometimes think, you have written something that makes sense, only to find that you have missed maybe simple things like technical stuff. Maybe you didn't put a comma, you're supposed to put a question mark, and all those things which is very important when you're writing. Or maybe you've left out a word, and you thought you wrote this word, only to find what you wrote it in heart, and then it's not there on your script. So you don't submit your work. Maybe what you can do is that you write, and then maybe close the laptop, take a break, and then maybe on the following day, when you have renewed strength and then when you are well rested, you can be able to reread your work, so that you can identify those minor mistakes, and then you can correct accordingly. And then you have to be aware of plagiarisms. Plagiarism, this was talked about on our last workshop also. Plagiarism is a punishable offense as per UNISA policies. So it's always important to reference your work so that you don't get in trouble. And then we're going to focus on our last type of exams, which are problem or calculation questions. So
Ms. Butulesi,
Sorry.
Yeah. I just want to say, if you see my face, you know that I'm just worried about the time. I heard you saying that you're almost done. So I just wanted to make you aware that we are running a bit over time. Thanks.
Okay, no, thank you so much. This is my last slide, so I should be finished in a few minutes. Okay, so these problem-solving questions, they vary in format from, they could be multiple choice to short answers to long calculations, and they frequently test your ability to apply the problem skills you learned in the module to new questions. Obviously, with problem or calculations, we are usually dealing with numbers. So, and then strategies for answering these, you must know your exam type. It's important to know what you can and cannot bring in with you for an in-person on in on online exams. So it might happen that the exam is open, is restricted or closed. What we mean by an open exam, we mean that you have access to any printed written or written material or calculator. So where do you find this information? You need to consult your tutorial letters, guys, because your tutorial letters have this kind of information of the type of exam you are writing, what time. I think you can also find this information on your My Unisas. So please make sure that you have this information in hand. And then it might happen that the exam is restricted, which means you can only bring specific item. Usually when you are doing math calculations questions, you are required to have a calculator. And sometimes you may be allowed to bring a formula sheet. And then if it's a closed exam, then you only have access to written and drawing instruments like your compasses, your rulers, and your projectors. And then you need to maintain a mathematics notebook. So this will make you make sure that you know your formulas and how to use them in case a formula sheet is not provided, because it might happen that you think that there'll be a formula sheet at the end of your question paper, only find it's not there. So please familiarize yourselves with the with formulas that are used in your respective modules. And then you must read through your questions. You read through your budget, your time, and then you answer accordingly. And then you must do the easy questions first, because you know with numbers it can get tricky. You get really dizzy very fast there. So you must start with the easy questions first. This is going to help you to warm up your brain, and then it's gonna calm your exam nerves. And then you need to practice before you sit down for that exams. You need to practice. You must do your textbooks examples without looking at the solutions. And then obviously you can, this is going to help you remember how to do them. You visit your past papers. I've already said perusing your past papers is very important. And then also do quizzes. You do quiz tests and test corrections. And then obviously you're gonna do examples on your textbooks, and then you're gonna look if you did it right, and then you can adjust accordingly to correct accordingly. Maybe you missed a step here and there, and then yeah, you move on. So that's it for me today. So good luck with your exams, guys. Thank you so much. Back to you, Miss Daisy.
Thank you so much, Ms. Buthelezi. That was really a very thorough overview of the different types of exams. Let's all give a very warm applause or hearts or whatever you would want to use on the chat. Thank you very much. Okay, so now we're moving over to Mr. Pignani. So I mentioned at the beginning that he is one of my colleagues. He's also a student, senior student counselor at the Counselling and Career Development at the Central Unit or in the Iskam Pahlele building. Mr. Pignani, you will be talking with us about exam integrity. Thank you very much. While we're waiting for Mr. Pignani, sorry to interrupt you. I saw some questions on the chat. I'm not sure. There are some people who joined after we made the announcements at the beginning. So number one, we are recording the session and you will have access to it once the meeting is finished. You will get a notification in Teams on this chat that the recording is now available. Then there were also questions about, things like finding past exam papers, when can we ask questions and all those things. We will have a Q&A session at the end of our presentations where you'll be able to ask. If you can help each other, please do so in the chat. But as I also mentioned at the beginning, please don't share telephone numbers or any other personal information. Rather than refer the person, for example, to the Telegram or the My Unisa that you would want to share with them. Thank you very much, Mr. Pignani.
I've just shared a little bit of my screen. However, there's a slight change on the program. So I will talk a little bit, maybe about 5 minutes, about what I'm presenting right now. But I want to give more time to the core technical skills that you will need. So I'll give it to my colleagues. Some of my time will be giving to my colleagues that will be doing with the exam from the exam department, and then those will be dealing with core technical skills, because those are the skills that you need. And also my colleagues are definitely, they will touch on these things. So as Unisa, we're talking about academic dishonesty and people who are cheating during the exam. And as I said, for my colleagues from the exam department will elaborate a little bit more on this one to tell you, but it suffices for me to say, if you are caught cheating, and you will be caught cheating, and my colleagues from the technical will explain how this happens. So it's when you, plagiarism is when you don't reference correctly. So you produce a work, as Snail was, Ms. Telezi was talking about, when you have an open book exam or when you have a portfolio take-home exam, and you don't reference correctly, and you take work from other people and you pass it as your own work. So that is plagiarism. And even when you have paraphrased it, use your own words, and the lecturer can see that the work actually is from so and so, or this work is from so and so, and do not reference it correctly. So you need to know how to reference correctly using the style that we use at UNISA, the guidelines that we use at UNISA. There are also people who are cheating. The cheating is when you're talking during the exam, asking questions from other people during exam, or you're asking answers from other people during exam. It doesn't matter where you are, but when you do this, then you'll be caught and you'll be flagged and you'll get zero. Okay. And there's contract cheating also when people pass messages through social media or through WhatsApp, or you actually get some people then to write on your behalf. So we are aware of all these kinds of cheating, and the UNISA is very strict on academic dishonesty. Okay, and when then we collude with other people, you work together, the people, or you ask someone else to write an exam for you, and we will pick it up that, and we will then, UNISA will come down very hard on you, and you will then complain and cry. So it's very important to understand that we are aware of a lot of kind of cheating. It's also when a person open different browsers, for example, and they're writing an exam, say MCQ exam, and they open different browsers and they're looking for answers and all these things. We get aware of, we can be we are aware of these things, and the technology that we are using will pick it up, and you'll be flagged. And it's very bad if you get flagged, because it's not just a zero that you will get, but it's also go on to your academic record that you actually got flagged for this because of your dishonesty, and it stays with you. So if you want to continue with your academic, you know, do your honors, your master's or stuff, all that, that thing will always appear because you were not honest. So it's very important. So my job, as I'm saying, I just want to talk for 5 minutes. My job here is to make you aware that we are aware of a lot. As UNISA, we are aware of academic dishonesty that takes place, and people, what they are actually using at some stage. And if you get caught, and you will be flagged, and the consequences will dire for you. So please refrain from not referencing, from cheating, using other people, using social media, asking other people to write for you, and writing together and discussing the paper with other students, and because all those things will be bad for you. So I'll just want to say that when it comes to dishonesty, but as I said, I want to give more time to my colleagues from the exam department and from the digital learning advisors that will talk about technical and say show you how we know that you are actually cheating and how we can caught you. Thank you very much, Lisa, for that. And I'll give it back to you so that we can give that more time to my colleagues. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Philiswe Maneli, and I'm going to be presenting on proctoring tools. I'm from the Department of Directorate of Student Assessment Administration under the proctoring offices, where we deal mainly about the proctoring tools, which will be the Invigilator app, IRIS, and Moodle proctoring. Okay, before I go into the proctoring tools, we have two categories of exemption that we applied here, and those will be the students who are incarcerated and the students who are differently abled. The incarcerated means the students who are in jail. So if you fall under these two categories, you are supposed to have already applied, or if you have not already done that, you can still do it prior to the commencement of the exam. And you can send your documentation, be it the letter from the doctor or the letter from the correctional services, to examdisabled@unisa.ac.za, so that you can be exempted from the uses of the proctoring tools. Okay, with the why are we using these proctoring tools as the university? As we all know that our examinations are now written online. So in order for us as the university to validate that the student who is registered with the university is the same one who's actually sitting for that exam, we have applied these academic integrity tools to ensure that we can be able to track that that information. So we use the Moodle app, the IRIS, and the Invigilator app. The Moodle app is the one that is used mainly for the MCQs question or the quiz question, which will be the multiple choice questions. So this tool can be downloaded from both your laptop, your desktop, or your smartphones. And how you actually access it is when you access your examination page, question paper, it's built in, then it automatically loads. And while you are writing your exam, then it will be taking a screenshot of, it will be taking pictures of you while you are writing your exam to make sure that the profile picture that we have as a university is the same as the student who is currently taking that examination. Okay, before I go on further, there are just a few things I would like to address, which were raised by the first speaker, Nontlantlaptilizi. I think it might have raised some confusion with the student, because I also saw on the chat box a student were actually confused now. She spoke of, especially on the issue of the take-home exam. With the take-home exam, we've got two categories. We've got open book exams, and we've also got closed book exams. With the open book exam, which is what she was referring to mainly, it's when the student is allowed to use other material, be it your study guide, your textbooks. You can go and search on Google Apps or any other search engines on your laptop. So that one is an open book where you are allowed to go and check while you are writing your exam. And then we've got a closed book exam. With the closed book exam, you're not supposed to be referencing anywhere. When you're writing your exam, it's like when you are writing it in your matric, you didn't have any material to assist you when you are writing. It's just you and your question paper and your pen, and you are answering from the knowledge that you've already acquired when you are studying. So I just wanted to make that variation so that we avoid the confusion that I already saw on the chat boxes. So with this one, you'll be given a time period. Most of the exams will be 2 hours, but there will be some 3 hours and 4 hours question paper that you'll have to sit in. And as soon as you're done with that exam, you'll have to submit the same day. So the one that Ms. Buthelezi was referring to is when you are writing portfolios, which are for postgrad. Postgrad is when you are studying after you've already attained your degree or your diploma. Those will be the postgrads, which will be the honors, the masters, and the doctorate. So with the undergraduate one, you write mainly the exam book questions, which will have time frames, and you submit on that very same day. Okay, I hope I have clarified that one. If there will be issues, I'll be attending to them after the presentation on the question and answer session. Okay, now going back to my presentation, we also have the IRIS, which deals with mainly the take-home exams and also the MCQs. With IRIS, it can only be downloaded from your laptop or your desktop, not on your smartphone. So with the first one, the Moodle, you can download it either on your laptop or your smartphone. But with the IRIS one, it mainly uses the laptop. You cannot use it on your phone. And also, we advise the student that if it's possible, please don't use the MacBook. There are some limitations with it, though you can still use it, but there are some technical issues that you may encounter with it. So if it's possible, you can use the other laptops, the Dell, the HP, your Acer, all those, and we also encourage students to use the Google Chrome, although you can still make use of the Microsoft Edge, but it works much nicer on the browser, Chrome. Sorry. What this app do, the IRIS app, it mainly records the students as they are writing their examinations. It takes a video of anything that is happening around the student, and the student is supposed to share, to scan their room prior to commencing their exam to see that there is no other laptop or any other person in the room that might be assisting the student while they are writing their examinations. Okay, some requirements that you'll need in order for you to download your IRIS. You will require to have the Microsoft operating system of a Windows 8 or Windows until Windows 10, meaning Windows 8, 9, or 10, or with a RAM space of 4 GB and a hard drive space of 140 MB to 200 MB. As I've already said, it is a that for EUC 1501
Ms. Maneni.
Any other colleges? Hello.
I'm so sorry. We lost you on the previous slide. Can you please just go back? We lost you there for a while in terms of your audio. If you could just go back to the previous slide. Yeah.
Okay. This one?
The one about IRIS, the requirements.
Yes, the requirements, yes.
Yeah.
So be this
you were
one.
Still talking about that it would be better to view the or to access IRIS on a laptop or PC with Chrome. I'm not sure if there's anything else that you... Yeah.
Saying it will be best if the student make sure that they have the latest, they update their software, that is the latest software to avoid any mishaps, and that the student must try to avoid using the MacBook laptop. And another thing that I would also like to emphasize, as students who are going to be utilizing laptops from work, please make sure that you get a approval from your work prior to the day of exam, at least for a week, because while we are using this the IRIS app, it will require you to open your location. So with the laptops from work, some of them, they don't give access to the location. So, and if you cannot share your location or share the microphones and your camera, you will not be able to use your IRIS. That means it won't be recording you. So we urge the student that if you know that the laptop that you are going to be using for your examination, it's from work, please make sure that you speak to your IT department prior to the exam to be granted access for the location so that it shares your location. All right. Okay, now I'm going back here. I'm not sure if you heard, but I'll just repeat it. I was saying that the students that are going to be using the IRIS will be students from the College of Science, Engineering and Technology, and also some of the students from College of Accounting Sciences who are doing the CTA. So only the student in Accounting and Sciences who are doing CTA will be using the IRIS, and also the student who are registered for the signature course of the end user computer, which is EUC 1501, will also be required to use the IRIS. So if you are registered in any of the above colleges, which is the Economic and Management Sciences, Law, Accounting Sciences, Education, Agriculture and Human Sciences, but you are registered for end user computer, you'll still be required to download the IRIS. Okay, and then the above colleges, which is the Economic and Management Sciences, the Law, Accounting, Education, College of Agriculture and Environmental Sciences, College of Human Sciences, they all make use of the Invigilator app and the model. So if you are registered in these six colleges, you will be required to download the Invigilator app and model. So with Invigilator app, only the student that will be writing the take-home exam, meaning the written exam, will be required to download the Invigilator app, which can be downloaded only on your smartphone. Only on your smartphone can you download the Invigilator app. Please do not download your Invigilator app on your laptop because it's got limitation and it's not compatible. Therefore, some of the features will not work on your laptop if you have downloaded the Invigilator app there. I cannot overemphasize that one. And if you're also going to be writing the quiz questions, then you will use your Moodle app. I hope I am clear on that one. So what does the Invigilator app do? The Invigilator app will take the selfies of the student while they are writing their exam, and the student are also supposed to allow the app to access their camera, their microphones, and their location, because before you use the invigilator app, you must allow it to share your location to make sure that there are no other students who are writing with you while you are writing the exam. You are not going to be sitting as a group discussing the paper as you're writing your exam. So, and the microphone is to make sure that the whatever that is being said around you that is recorded, and we do flag the student for microphone. So if there are speeches that will be detected while you are writing, we'll flag you and we'll listen to each and every thing that you was happening while you are writing. If it was just a general talk, because we understand that we have different family dynamics, you might be staying with your whole family, and while we are writing at the background, Gogo or maybe mommy and the uncles will be chatting at the background. So we will be listening to what they are saying. If we hear that it's not exam related, we'll then release your results. But if we can hear that while you are writing exam, what is being discussed there is related to the paper, to the question paper that you are writing, you will be flagged and you'll be taken to a DC for disciplinary. And then we're also going to automatically flag the student who are writing in close proximity with each other, meaning that if you are sharing the same room, be it the regional office study center, you are writing in the same place, we are going to flag you automatically. But that doesn't mean we'll be taking you to a DC office. You will be flagged and we'll take your script to the lecturer so that they can compare the answer scripts that the two students have. If this lecturer checked the answer scripts and feel that the student were working together, discussing their answers, they will be taken through to a disciplinary and your results will not be released. But if when the lecturer checks the two different scripts and sees that the student might have been sitting close to each other, but their work, it's not the same work, their results will then be released. And we also have issues of the student that are using the ghost writers, or those people that are sending you SMSs to say, we can assist you with your exam, just buy the paper for 350 Rand or 180, we'll send you all the answers. If you're one of those students who does that, please note that our system are very advanced. We'll pick you up and the lecturer will confirm that the work, it doesn't matter, even if it's like communication whereby there are 5,000 students who are registered for COM 1501. If you do that and you buy the paper, the system will pick up the similarities. And then when the lecturer checks and sees that indeed this student, it's the work from the same person, you will be flagged and you will be taken in for a disciplinary. And you need to understand that when you are taking in for a disciplinary, you can be charged for up to 5 years. Meaning that for 5 years, you cannot register with any other university. You are going to be flagged and blacklisted with all the other university, not only with UNISA, but your VETS, your UJs, your Mpumalanga University, any other university that is here, you will not be able to register for 5 years up until your 5 years is over. So we really, we've been doing these drives as a university, and we also had the pleasure room awareness. We were teaching the student because we realized that last year we had lots of issues on social media. A student complaining that we would withheld their results, we're not releasing their results, and the university is trying to trap them, everything. So now university has taken a stance that we're going to bring awareness to students so that you know exactly what is required of you. Hence, with each and every exam, deferred comments, we send you the online exam rules. Please read them carefully. Make sure you abide with each and every clause that is written there. Because failure to do so, you might either be taken for disciplinary or your results might be withheld by the university, and you'll have to either re-register for that module or you'll have to sit for the next coming exam in order for you to write. So if we also have what we call an out of app time. So if you're going to have a total of 10 minutes out of app during your examinations, please know that we are going to flag you and you are not going to get your results. You are not going to get your results if you are going to be flagged for more than 10 minutes during the duration of your examinations. Okay. So with the invigilator app, I've already stated that this app, it will be recording you. Anything that has been said around you will record your location and also record the script similarities on it. All right. I'm just going to quickly play a recording for the invigilator app that will be showing the student how to download the Invigilator app. The Invigilator app, by the way, can be downloaded on any Apple stores on your laptop, on your smartphone, sort of that. So you can download it the same way that you'll be downloading Instagram, your TikTok, your WhatsApp. You simply go to the Play Store and then you type Invigilator app. And then, but I'm going to play a video for you that will show you exactly what is expected of you as a student while you are writing.
Welcome to the Invigilator app. This app helps you complete non-venue-based assessments safely and securely without being invasive or taking up too much of your time. All you need is a charged smartphone with a camera and a small amount of data or a Wi-Fi connection. The Invigilator app helps maintain academic integrity during non-venue-based assessments. How does it do this? While you are writing your exam, the Invigilator app takes random audio recordings, and if speech is detected, the recording is flagged for your lecturer to review. There will also be selfie and photo requests used to verify your identity and prevent unethical behavior. Your lecturer sets up the amount of photos the app will ask for and the audio recordings it will capture. Let's show you step by step what that looks like. 1. Begin by making sure your phone's operating system is up to date, and then start downloading the app on the Google Play Store, Apple App Store, or Huawei App Gallery. 2. Register as a student by signing up with your details. You will need to use your institutional email address, the one with your student number, and not your personal email address. A verification code or one-time PIN will be sent to your email address to complete the registration. 3. Remember to save and keep your password safe. We've built in a password reset function just in case though. 4. When you log in for the first time, the app will calibrate by requesting specific actions. This is to ensure your phone is compatible. 5. Permission will be requested to access your camera and microphones. You will need to grant the app access in order for you to complete your assessment. 6. Set up your master selfie by clicking the camera icon when prompted to do so. Your face should be evenly lit and visible. We recommend you remove your glasses and any face coverings, such as a mask. This will be the photo that the facial recognition will run selfies against and flag if there is an unfamiliar selfie taken during an exam. Now you're all set to start an assessment. 7. You will need internet connection at the beginning and at the end of your assessment. 8. When commencing an exam, log into the app and the dashboard will load. First, you will need to scan the QR code or enter the exam code. This is the set of digits just below the QR code block. The QR code will be found either on your exam or shared by your lecturer before the assessment. 9. Once the code is scanned, the timer and invigilation will begin. You'll see the photo dock and the time remaining in the bottom right corner. 10. No one likes disruptions. Your phone can be on silent, but check that your media volume is turned up to hear the app notifications. 11. You can now place your cell phone next to you and begin your exam. 12. If you only have one device, you can press the Access LMS button to access your University Learning Management System through our in-app browser. This will allow you to write your assessment on your phone while still being invigilated by the app. 13. The app will notify you at random intervals for predetermined requests that your lecturer has set up. 14. Pop-up requests will ask for specific photos. In this example, it's a photo of your exam paper. 15. Once you've taken the photo, it will load into the photo box. 16. Now it's asking for a selfie. If your face is not visible, an error message will appear. 17. Action prompts have set time limits and will be flagged for your lecturer to review if not completed within that time. 18. If you are writing an online assessment on your LMS, which is your learning management system, you might be required to enter a verification code as an answer to one of the questions. Should you receive this request, there will be a button on the app saying "Show exam code to enter." Only select this once you are on the question requesting this code. 19. If your exam is handwritten, you may be prompted to take photos of all the pages in your exam script at the end of your assessment to ensure that there is no additional writing after the allocated time is over. 20. What happens if you finish early? If your lecturer chose to allow you to end the assessment early, you can click on the I am finished button. 21. You are not allowed to exit the app at any time during the invigilation for any reason other than to WhatsApp the invigilator help desk. Any out-of-app time will be available for your lecturer to review. 22. When the timer runs out, it will load the files onto the cloud. This is when you'll need data or a Wi-Fi connection. 23. This pop-up means the invigilator app has successfully uploaded all the information. You can double check if everything was uploaded by selecting the top left button to view your uploads. Now you're all done. Your lecturer will review the photos and recordings the app sends through. Don't worry about your personal or test data. It's completely safe and secure. Your information is only used for assessment purposes and then will be deleted later. So, how can you prepare for an assessment using the Invigilator app? Download the app ahead of time to be sure it's compatible with your phone. Before each assessment, check that your app is updated. Refer to the student user guide that you received from your lecturer to locate a demo QR code for you to practice using the app. Do this well in advance to ensure you're familiar with the process. Charge your phone fully before the assessment to ensure that you have sufficient battery. You'll need an internet connection for the following. 1. Registering for the first time. 2. Logging in. 3. Scanning the QR code or access code to enter the exam. 4. Uploading your Invigilator data at the end of the exam. Visit our website for more resources, guidance, and frequently asked questions, or contact our WhatsApp help desk for technical support. Now you're ready to use the Invigilator app. All the best with your upcoming assessment.
Okay, that is what will be required for your Invigilator app. And now I'm going to help the students to download the iris on their laptop. So I'll quickly go in there. Okay, now I'm going to take you through on the steps that will be required for you to download your iris on your laptop. Okay, you'll go to your search engine and then you type iris download. And then when the results come up, you'll click the first one that has an orange block here. And this page will come up and then you come to this one depending on the browser that you are using. If you're going to be using the Google Chrome, you'll click on the first one. If you're going to use the Microsoft Edge, you'll click the second one. So I'm doing my demo on the Google app, on the Chrome. So I'm going to click the first one. Okay, and this block will come up here. And here it says add to Chrome. You click there here where it says add to Chrome. And this pop-up block will come up that says add Iris. And then you'll say add extension. As soon as you click on add extension, then you'll see here your Iris is downloading quickly. And now your Iris is downloaded. Here is your Iris Chrome on the side now showing next to your extension. So when we're assisting you and says go to the extensions, it will mean come here. Okay, now when I close here, then the Iris disappears. So if on the day that you are writing your exam, you see that your Iris is not showing here, we'll tell you that come to the extension. The extension will be this part that looks like a piece of a puzzle. You click it on you. When you click on it, then here is your Iris showing here. Then what you'll simply do, you'll come to this little pin and you click on the pin. As soon as you click on this pin, then your Iris pop here on top. So anytime that you are writing your exam, if your Iris is not showing here, know that you're not going to be recorded. And if you are not recorded, then you're not going to get your results. So please make sure that it's always here, showing next to your extensions. So now after you've done this, you're going to right click here on your Iris. As soon as you right click, then you come here. You are going to check your permissions. Remember, I said when you are writing on your Iris, you need to make sure that you allow Iris to share your location, to share your camera and your microphones. So these first three, you must always make sure that they are on the allow. So if it says a block, know that your Iris is not going to work. So it must always be on allow. Okay, so these three things you must always make sure. And then the other one, whenever a student will have space problem, issues with the space or the laptop that is very slow, when you call in for us to assist, we'll always tell you that clear the cache. So when you tell the student to clear the cache, they won't know. But when you simply either go here on this three blocks on the side and you come to settings, okay, let me do it the quicker way instead of coming here because the settings takes a while. It will tell you that click on Control, Shift, and Delete. If you click on those three keys on your keyboard, Control, Shift, and Delete, then this little pop-up block will come up. And when it comes up, it will tell you that come here to the time range. On the time range, we'll check, and normally it will be on the last 24 hours. Most of the laptop, they're normally on this one. But if you come to your time range, always come to the last time, and then you say clear cache. When you clear this one, then it will allow your computer to run faster. So make sure that you always do this exercise to make sure that your computer is running quicker. All right. That is how you're going to be downloading your Iris on your laptop. Now, back to my presentation. Okay, the important issues that you need to know as a student, if we are going to be using your friend or your mother's or your dad's laptop and cell phone to download your or to use for your app. Because sometimes other students will say, I already registered on the app last year, but I had issues with my phone, or my phone was stolen. So I simply took my sister's or my mom's Invigilator app to write. Yes, you are allowed to use another person's app, but make sure that you still log in with your own credentials, meaning you'll have to go and log out on that person's credential and log back in with your own credential, which will be your own student number and your password. Because if you use somebody else's credentials, you won't get your results. We cannot overemphasize that one. And for the student who will be using their Iris, we know some students, they use their WhatsApp on their laptops, and they some even use the Teams. It might be Teams from your work, where you schedule you you're scheduling for the meetings, please make sure if you're going to be using Teams to write your on the day of exam, please set it or change the status to do not disturb so that you won't get the pop-up messages that will come in as you're writing your exam. Because when you get those pop-ups, we're going to flag you. So to avoid any disruptions or mishap while you're writing your exam, please that you make sure you eliminate these things. And another thing, when you're writing your exam on the day when you're uploading now your invigilator results, please, and the invigilator app will always close after 8 minutes. After it says that the exam has period time has finished, meaning your 2 hours is now over, it will then allow you to upload the results that was taken, meaning all the promptings of take your selfie, take a picture of your ID copy, take a picture of the exam script that you are writing. When you are done all that, at the end, you'll have to upload that data. So when you upload that data, it only allows you 8 minutes. But if you get challenges with your network and it becomes slow after you've clicked on end assessment, don't panic, just leave it as long as you've already clicked on upload assessment. If it's a buffering, just go to my exam portal and finalize that submission. The one on my exam portal will always be open for 30 minutes after the exam has closed. Please note this information is very important. My invigilator app, it's only open for 8 minutes after exam is closed, but my exam portal is open for 30 minutes. But this 30 minutes, it's not for students to continue writing, but it's for them to start uploading. The reason why we give you 30 minutes is in case you're having technical issues, then you are still able to either call us. I'm also going to share our help desk number that you can call us to say we're having problems uploading on the on my exam portal, and we can still be able to assist you. But if you wait until the last minute and you try to upload at that time, you might not be able to upload because the system will then be congested at that time. And 1 minute later, your exam script will not be marked. 1 minute later, your exam script will not be marked. The lecturers always share also on their site the contingency link. If the student they're having problem with uploading on my exam portal, then you can upload on the contingency link. Failure to upload on these two, if you have successfully uploaded on Invigilator app, we can still mark that script that would have been uploaded on the Invigilator app, meaning those photos that you will have taken while writing your exam, we will then draw those and mark them. If you are not able to upload on both the My Exam portal and the contingency link, the reason we're giving this student information is that so that when you scan, when they say take the pages or scan, you scan each and every page. Students have tendencies of scanning either their question paper, some are even sillier that they will scan a receipt or an airtime and send it. Unfortunately, if we don't have any submission that we found on my exam portal and contingency link, we're going to draw that receipt or that airtime and send it through to your lecturer, and you will then obtain a zero mark. That means you would have failed the module. So please make sure that you prioritize on uploading on the on my exam portal. And if the student upload the correct answer script on Invigilator app, however, failed to upload the correct one on my exam portal or the contingency link, note that we are not going to draw the one from the Invigilator app, because the one that you will have uploaded on my exam portal will be seen as the primary one and will be the one that will be marked by your lecturer. So if you uploaded only one page of answer script on my exam portal, that is what is going to be marked by your lecturer, not what will be on the invigilator app. Even if on the invigilator app, you would have submitted the whole answer script. And since I said that if you're having issues with the invigilator app, it's buffering, please note that you can always go back to the invigilator app either later on that same day. And how you normally go, you'll just go and click on the three lines that will be on your left-hand side of the screen. When you click them, then it will give you options. You go to the option that will say pending uploads. Then when you go to the one that says pending upload, it will show any uploads that are still pending on the system for you to finalize. Then you can see which one didn't go through. Then you just simply go and click on that one and submit. The one that would have uploaded successfully will always have a reference number next to that module code. So it will be the module code and the date where it was written and the reference number. So if it doesn't have the reference number or it's still written processing, know that it has not come to us. You'll need to click on it and finalize that submission. As a student, you have 48 hours to finalize that submission. With that submission, you won't be able to add anything new because it will be the data that you've already taken while you are writing the exam. The system will send you SMSs notifying you and also email notifying you that you need to finalize a submission. If you fail to finalize that submission 48 hours after the date of the examination, then you're not going to get your results. So I hope I'm very clear. I know I overemphasize these issues because we normally have lots of queries emanating from these. Hence, I took time to explain this very thoroughly. Now I'm going to share just a quick error messages that students might have when they are writing their examinations. I'm just going to quickly run through them so that I allow the other speakers to also finalize, to also share what they have. Okay, I'm just going to share this. It doesn't allow me to enlarge it. So if I know last week, most of the students were receiving these messages when they are trying to download their Invigilator app. It says that the email has not been confirmed by the university. Please check your email or contact your university to get the email confirmed. It's because the student were not yet granted licenses for the Invigilator app. But now that the admission, the exam admission have run, if you are still getting this issue, please contact us at proctoringenquiries@unisa.ac.za. If you are still getting this message, please make us aware so that we can finalize your application, because I know now you're not supposed to be having these issues anymore. All right. And if you have this one that says password incorrect, like any other one where your password is incorrect, you have an option of resetting your password. Okay, and then we have an issue. If you get the error code that says there was the issue is you've already scanned this code and started the exam, meaning that you've already scanned your QR code. However, this is always coming. Some of the phones require them to be require student to put them on the charger while writing your exam. So if you're having this issue, just know that just put your phone on the on the charger while writing and let it stay there during the duration of your exam.
That's amazing.
And then, yes.
My apologies. We're still seeing the screen about the error of the email that has not been confirmed.
Didn't move.
Yeah.
That is strange because from my side it's moving.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you see now?
Yes, it's now on the screen about the application. It's warning you to plug in. Now you're showing the QR code.
Yes.
Yep.
All right. Yes. This one is where you've already scanned in your QR code, but this error message is coming. This is the one that you just have to plug in your cell phone for the duration of the exam. You don't have to panic, just plug in your phone and then continue writing. And then this one that says there was an error starting the exam. The error is the exam can only be started between this period on this date. That means you have scanned the QR code late. So if you scan the QR code just 1 minute after it has closed, our QR code, we normally open them for 45 minutes, meaning if your exam is going to be starting at 8 o'clock, the QR code will open from 7:45, meaning 15 minutes prior to the exam commence and 30 minutes during the exam. So meaning it will be 15 minutes before the exam start. And when the exam start from 8 until 8:30, the QR code will still be open. If you scan your QR code at 8:31, then you're going to get this error message because your QR code, you will have been late for scanning the QR code. And then when it says the PDF viewer error, when you get this exclamation mark, it means you just simply need to make sure that the PDF viewer you are using is the latest one. So make sure that before the date of the exam that you get the latest version. And then this is the message I was referring to, that if you didn't finish your upload, then you'll get this message that says that this module course have not, the results are still pending. You just go to your app and then on that dashboard, you go to that three lines I was referring to, and you go where it says pending results. The module will show there. You simply click on the module that doesn't have, that is still pending, and you finish your submission. And if you get these results, that means all these modules, they've been received, they all have reference number, and it says that the module code, the reference number and the date that it was written and the time it was uploaded, that means everything was in order from your side. So I think that is all on my side. Let me, oh, okay. With the load shedding issue, and I saw some students, they said their laptops are slow, others are crashing and everything. Yeah. All those issues of laptop and load shedding and cameras that are not working and the software that is not updated. As Unisa, we provide students with the software Microsoft 365. So if you have any other software that you are using that is not updated, please note that these are not university's responsibility. As the university, we try to meet you. And if it's on the day of your exam, you happen to have a load shedding in your area, please try to make alternative arrangement and move to a place where there is no load shedding, or if possible, just check with the regional office or regional hub near you if they do allow students to come and write their exams there. Please check these things prior to the day of your exam to eliminate unnecessary stress. I know we have not had load shedding now for almost a month, but if they do come back after we vote, please make sure you make those necessary arrangements. Okay, our numbers, as I promised, we'll share. We have our own help desk line that deals with proctoring issues, all proctoring issues that I've mentioned today. If you have problem, you can contact us at 011-471-2433. This is for all proctoring related queries. And then if you have issues with your Invigilator app only, for the Invigilator app, you're going to take the screenshots of the problem that you are encountering, and you send that screenshot of that issue to this WhatsApp number, 073-505-8273. This is for the screenshots only of the Invigilator app. And we also have an email where you can send us an email on proctoring inquiries at unisa.hc.za. But please don't send the email to say I'm struggling to download or I'm struggling to upload, because those are the real-time issues. You need to call us for such. Otherwise, if you're going to send us an email in the morning to say I have a problem to download, and we can only read that email at 2:45 in the afternoon, it is no use. You'll have to just go and wait for the next opportunity. And if it was already a second opportunity, you'll then have to go and re-register. So please, let's also know what is expected of us as students. So thank you so much. My parting word with you is that study to show yourself approved, a workman who's not afraid, but rightly dividing the word of truth. And I thank you. I'll take your questions later.
Thank you so much, Ms. Maneli. Quite a lot of information, but very thorough. I have also, as you were talking, posted some of the slides, for example, the contact information on the chat, and also a link to the exam guide on my Unisa, which is also quite important for you to familiarize with yourself with. It also covers some of the issues that Ms. Maneli showed us this morning. So I'm going to ask Mr. Mulatsi to please share what you plan to share with us this morning. Mr. Mulatsi.
Thank you very much. And then afternoon to everyone. Mr. Hazel, I think after my colleague has spoken, she have touched on most issues that I was called to come and touch on a technical aspect of it. The matter that I can touch on now, it's I think she covered almost everything. The thing that I've realized students might be still struggling with, it might be an issue of uploading a profile picture on my Unisa, because I was trying to listen to what she was touching on, and I've realized she did a good job. I'm really pleased, and then I'm speechless. What I can just project now, it will be just few things: where to find the exam portal, and then maybe to demonstrate what they will be out, they will be able to log in, then to upload the profile picture, which that will be just 5 to 10 minutes. It won't take long. And again, I thank you, Ms. Maneli, and I thank you for the organizers. This is a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thing that we're providing to students. As I'm trying to share my screen, let me share a window, not a screen. My name is Ronald Rezani Mlaudzi. I'm a digital learning advisor at Unisa, based in Sunnyside Hub. We are just next to SKM Pakele building, building 14. Now, I will prefer to do live because most of the things that were on my slide are covered. The slide one, it will be how to upload your profile picture. As you heard all the previous speakers that are talking about plagiarism, they talk of you must upload it. There must be a picture on your profile. Now you go on, you log in on my Unisa. When you log in on my Unisa, before you even tap to any tab, desktop or my modules, you just go on the top right hand side. There will be, you'll find your initials there. When you go to the initials, when you click on the drop down arrow, you're going to find a tab says accessibility, profile, grades, calendar, private files, reports, preference, and logout. Now, what you're going to focus on, it will be you go to profile. When you click on profile, it's going to give you the information about yourself. On the far left-hand side, it gives your name, and you can see there's a need, there's a round, that's a circle that shows that there must be a picture that's uploaded. You're going to click on edit profile. When you click on edit profile, it's going to give you information about you. You scroll down up until you find a tab or a slide that talks about user picture. The first one, it will be current picture, which is none. New picture, there is a file here on top. Those who are good with computers, we advise you can even drag and just drop it here, it will be fine. But if you are not that good with computers, you click on a file. When you click on a file, it will give you this on the top left, which says recent files, upload files, URL downloader, private files, or Wikimedia. You go and select upload a file. When you click on an upload a file, on the right hand side, there will pop up attachment, and you go and click underneath attachment, we say choose a file. Choosing a file is just saying to you, you must know where your picture is. Those who will say they prefer to take a picture, they will take a picture, but those who have downloaded the picture, who will be using a laptop or a desktop, you go where your picture is. In this case, I'll just go and take a random picture that I took. Then I'll come here and say, this is the picture I want to use, upload. It will give me the name of the picture, upload a file, and then it wants me to confirm, is this the picture that you want to upload? It accepts this, and then my picture, I just have to update. When I click update, there we are. The picture is uploaded. Now, according to the university rule, you must do this before you write your exam, so that when we check the person who's taking selfie on your Invigilator app, we compare with the picture that you have given us before. Now, we have seen people trying to dodge this. They try to just take a ceiling and say that's a picture. That might work against you when we have to compare the picture that we must have on a profile. You might be penalized based on not uploading as it was indicated from the beginning. I hope that I'm clear. I'll just repeat for those who have maybe have missed it. On your initials, you will click on initials, you go and click profile. When you click on profile, you go and click edit profile, and then you scroll down. You'll find where it says use picture, and then you won't have a delete picture, because in this case you won't have a picture. Let me just delete this, so that when I start it, we start in the same page. Now I've just deleted my picture. When you log in, you go to your initials on the top right, drop down, profile. On a profile, when you click profile, it will open this page. You go to edit profile. When you click edit, you just have to scroll a little. This will be a little bit difficult for those who are using a mobile, because a mobile screen, it's compact. We took all this screen and then squeeze it in. Now, on a mobile version, let me just go back. Let me go to my dashboard. On your mobile version, this is how this will be like. Now, it will be difficult to use a mobile. That's why you even hear, they always say, please use a bigger screen, use a laptop if you have a laptop than using a mobile, because our LMS, when it comes to mobile, we have to squeeze everything so that you will be able to read, but it won't be the same as the one that you see on your desktop or on your laptop. Now, what the difference will be, just now, instead of seeing all things that you were seeing before, it will just start by giving you where you have to upload a profile. Then now, when you click on edit, you scroll down. This page, it's under user profile. This, which is, it will, when you put your cursor, it will say add. When you click add, it will ask you to choose. Anything won't be chosen here, because it will be your first time going on this page. Now you will have to go and click on upload a file, so that whatever is happening on the right hand side should appear. If you didn't choose that, you won't be able to upload a file unless you have it somewhere in a URL or private files. But if you have taken a picture or downloaded it or saved it somewhere, you'll go and click choose file. And then now it's asking you, where is the file? You must know where the picture you are looking for. You select and then you click open and then you upload. This is just for you to confirm, is this the picture that you want to use? This is how it will look like. If you are fine with it, you scroll down and then you come and click upload profile. Now, by doing that, your profile will appear on the top right-hand side. It means even when they say you have used Invigilator app, but now this was a lady, today we see somebody with PS, we come and compare here. Said, but this, the person was writing and this is two different people. Now, I'll log out here. When we go for exams, we have seen students coming to computer labs complain, hey, I went to my Unisa, there's no exams. Let's read announcement from the lectures. They normally send them on time before you go to write. Now, when you go to my Unisa, we don't log on modules unless it was instructed by the lecture. That's why I'm emphasizing the issue of reading announcement. Unless the lecture emphasizes it, your exam, you are going to find it under this link. And when you click here, you will have exam based on the day. If I check today is the 30th, the 30th is the day that has been clicked. This one exam, there's a test that is written today. Now you will see it here on this page where your exams is. Then from there you will click on that. That's where you'll be requested to log in, like the way you logged in on my Unisa. When you click here, it will request you to type your username. In this case, I will use my username and the password which I use to log in on my Unisa. But because I'm not scheduled to write that exam, I'll get this message. I am not part of those who are going to write the exam. One thing that you know, you must know as student, there are exams that you must get a permission as student. There are exams that if you didn't submit assignment number one, you won't be able to write. Even if your friend is going to write you the exam, it doesn't mean automatically you're going to write. You must be granted a permission to write exam. Now, if your timetable date doesn't appear, it's not a mistake. It means you didn't qualify for that exam. You have to go through and go to your lecture and ask, or go to admin department to ask, hey, my colleagues, my fellow students are writing this and then I'm not writing. They will explain what happened. Now, when you get this, it means, yes, they are writing exam, but I don't have access to this. Now, the other problem that we have, this error message comes especially to those who work, who are going to use work laptops. If you are going to use work laptops and at your work, it just happens that you use Office 365. Make sure that you log out on your work emails or work Office 365 that you have logged in. Because when you try to log in using the student and then there's a default Office 365 that's running, it's going to give you an error like this and it will frustrate you. Now prepare, as you indicated, prepare a day before, make sure that you log out from there, make sure that everything is taken off. Those who are going to use work email as indicated, work laptops as indicated, please make sure that you go to your ICT department, especially those who will be using Iris, request them to remove the proxy settings. It becomes a serious problem when people try to log in with proxy settings, because the proxy will be saying, we don't trust Unisa page. We don't want anyone to come in our area if they're using Unisa. Now it's going to frustrate you. You will be frustrated. And when you try to call the help desk, you may find that the time is going. Please, those are the little things that many of us, we end up losing because of not testing our machine prior to exam. Don't wait for the day of exam. At least 2-3 days before exam, make sure that your machine meets, make sure that everything too, because if you check on that timetable, you have a list of 5 days of exams that will be written. They give a timetable for at least 5 days prior to your exam. If I'm writing on the 4th, I know that on the 4th, when you click on the 4th, you must be able to have things if there's something that is uploaded. But because there's nothing that is uploaded now, there's nothing that you will be able to see. Now, this is your responsibility as your student to test your gadget before the exam date. It's your responsibility of your student to make sure that when you say my invigilator is working, you are sure of that it's working. You have tested it. It allows you to test it, and then you test it and you are sure that you know how to upload or you anything that you need prior to that. Now, we have seen a huge number now of students complaining about the assignment that they were writing, which is a module proctoring tool. A module proctoring tool will always ask you to use a camera, as it was indicated before. It's your responsibility to make sure that you have a gadget that will do that. Now, how do you do that? I'm going to use an exam guide to just go through the ADOF. Every work that I'm doing it, it's credited to ADOF. It's not my work. It's a work that the ADOF have created. We thank them for a wonderful work that they've done. They've made our life easier. When I'm ADOF, let me... my MOOC exam. Even the MOOC exam is not my work. It's an ADOF work, which is part of Unisa. I'm just waiting for it to open so that I can do this practically, whatever that it was taken through, so that we are on the same page. Now on ADOF, you can get all this. Those who want to test, they can just go to adof.unisa.ac.zt. It's Unisa Academic Development Open Virtual Hub, where you will get all these things that were, majority of things that were covered. Now on, I want to do a module proctoring tool. Now on module proctoring tool, as indicated, it will be a multiple choice. Some of you are lucky you did that on when you were doing your assignments. Now, the moment I click, because I've resetted my, I've cleaned my cache, it wants me on the top left to say, allow a camera. If I don't allow a camera, I won't be able to write this exam or this assignment. Now, in this case, you won't be able to write an exam if you don't go there and then click allow a camera. The moment you click allow a camera, you scroll down and you go to say attempt a quiz. Now it says attempt a quiz, it gives me a camera, I can see myself, but if I don't clearly agree with the validation process, I won't be able to go and click start. You see, the moment I go to start, it gives me, it doesn't allow. Now you must make sure that you agree with the validation process, and then you go and click start. When you click start, you are able now to access your exam. I can see the exam question paper. I can see myself on the other end. Now, there is a time that somebody won't come and say, I'm not understanding what's happening. I was surprised the time. The university have also given you a time so that you can see how the time is lapsing. When you select, what is the UNISA exam platform? It's platform for student now. This you were given at the beginning of this workshop to say you must read all questions to understand. Don't just say when you feel like the first one is, oh, this is a close, and then you go and select. We read all of them as indicated and you understand. Now the exam platform, it's a platform for writing the exam, online exams. I'll go and select this and then click next. Now my exam is still counting. My camera up in front of me is still on. Now I'm continuing with my exam. It says, what is a proctoring tool? Now, this is when you're doing the practice, it will be asking you this. Now, let's say I don't know the answer of this, but you are advised to not pass any exam, because if you pass any question without answering, if I pass this, the system will allow me to pass it. But you may find it difficult to go back to answer that. Again, the time is against you if you're a student with special need, which you need. Now, I'm answering this as a demo, just to show what happens when you're writing an exam, when you are using a proctoring tool. Now, these questions are most frequent. This is the question that were covered by the speakers, the previous speakers. You see the issue of just picking. If one will just come and pick it because they read and stop. But when you read going down, there is something like take a screenshot of evidence of the problem, email to preserve, like using the email, my life email. You choose what is the best. And then now here, this is when you said you are done with your assignment. But there's an assignment that there's an exam that I didn't answer. In some modules, when you click back, it won't give you return to attempt. It means when you saw your question and you go next, you won't be able to go and click on it again, meaning you are going to submit whatever. And after clicking submit, it asks you, are you sure you want to submit submit all and finish? You said yes, you have submitted your exam. When you have submitted exam, you must get something like this to say you have submitted at this time. This is those who are doing assignment that are multiple choice, they have received this. This, it won't be anything new. To save time, I think that's all that I will cover now. And thank you very much for your time, ma'am.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mlautsi. I think it's really appreciated the practical way that you showed us now some of the challenges. And thank you also for sharing the information with students. We have run out of time in terms of our program, but what I would like to do is I see that Ms. Maneli has been answering questions on the chat. If there are any burning questions from students that may have not been answered on the chat, I will allow for about 5 minutes for us to do that. So you're welcome to raise your hand so that we can unmute your microphone. But please remember to keep it as short as possible and try not to ask questions that have already been posted and answered on the chat. What we will do with the one topic that we didn't manage to talk about in detail today is the exam anxiety. So what we will do is to share the slides with you as well as the recording of a previous presentation that we did about exam anxiety. But we will also ask Ms. Nalushi after the Q&A session if she could just share with us in about 5 to 10 minutes the most important parts of what she wanted to share with you this morning. So please, if you would want to ask a question now, either post it in the chat or then just raise your hand so that we can unmute your microphones. I see that there are already hands up, so I'm just going to call you in the order that you've put them up.
Hi, can everyone hear me?
Yes.
Oh, perfect. Thank you. I just have two quick questions with regards to the past exam papers. I noticed a lot of people were also asking, where do we find past exam papers?
Thank you for the question. I'm wondering if our colleagues, Ms. Maneli or Mr. Mlautsi, if you have any information that you can share. What the position of UNISA is in terms of past exam papers and how to access those. Ms. Maneli?
Thank you, Leza. What I understand, the lecturer will normally share those with the student on my UNISA. However, the university is going against that now of sharing the previous question papers. So you can just inquire from your lecturer if the lecturer is allowed to share the question paper. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So if I understand correctly, the position is that at the discretion of the lecturer, they will share past exam papers. Remember, just in terms of past exam papers, is that everything that you need to prepare for the exams and also the nature of the questions that will be asked and the format of the questions will be illustrated in terms of the assignments that you are submitting. So if you need to have access to types of questions to help yourself prepare for the exams, and if the lecturer is then not in the position to share past exam papers, use your learning outcomes, use your assignment questions to help you practice, writing an exam. And then also, if I remember correctly, with multiple choice questions or question papers, those are definitely, those can't be shared. But there may be some lecturers that could share past exam papers, but that will then be through an announcement or in one of your tutorial letters for for the specific module.
Yes, that is correct. And sorry, Leza, while I'm still on the podium, can I quickly just share? I see a lot of students are asking how they're going to see the proctoring tool that they require to use for the day. Can I just quickly share with the student how to see that? Thank you. I'll share my screen quickly. I have posted the link. When you click on the link that I've posted in the group, let's say, for example, you are writing a communication, MNG. That means they have not loaded the ones that will be written now in May, June, but they will be loaded by the time the exam is been written. So you'll just simply come here and let's say you're writing MNG 3701, and then it will select the proctoring tool that you are writing. Like, for example, here when I say MNG 37, it tells you the type of assessment. It will tell you to take home, and it uses the proctoring tool. And let's say, for example, the INF. Yes, with the INF, it's different ones, but they're all going to be using the IRIS. But you see, there's INF 1520, that is an MCQ quiz question. But for INF 4817, that will be the take home, and they also use a IRIS app. So that's how you're going to be distinguishing which type of exam you're going to be writing and on which proctoring tool you're going to be using in. So I have posted this link. You can use it. Thank you so much, Lel.
Yes, just I don't know if it's a silly question, but I just wanted to ask, does Unisa not offer in-person or venue-based exams at all anymore?
Ms. Manini, would you be able to come in?
Okay, no. The only venue-based exam that we have, it's for the CTA only. But all the other colleges and qualifications, they don't have. It's only online. Thank you. Okay,
thank you. I appreciate the feedback.
Pleasure.
Ms. Manili, just a follow-up question. At the beginning of your presentation, you spoke about incarcerated students and students with different abilities. They could apply to be exempted. So would they still complete an online exam but not have to use the proctoring tools, or how does that work for them?
Yes, they still do the online exam, but they are exempted from the proctoring tools. So meaning even those who are going to be using the model, they are still going to use the model, but they are not going to be penalized for not using it as a proctoring.
So we went through all the chat questions. And please, as Ms. Manelli indicated, you've got the contact details. You have links to that complete exam guide. So please also take some time. The reason why we, or as we were planning for the session this morning, we thought that it's important for us because now with the exams, you have kind of two things to master. So on the one hand, you need to have knowledge about the content that you're going to write for the exam, so your module knowledge. But then it's also important for you to feel confident in terms of using the online exam tools and the proctoring tools. Ms. Manili, there's just one question that I think we could also ask. In the instance where a student would only have a phone, for example, and they don't have a laptop or PC, can they use just their phones to write the exams?
Oh, thank you for that question. Yes, I forgot to address that. I saw there were also issues about that. Yes, if the student is going to be using one cell phone to be invigilated, meaning for invigilation and also to write the exam, yes, you can use one phone. And what you simply do, you go on the top left corner, it will have a LMS. So when you need to go and access your question paper, you just go there on top and click that LMS. It will then take you to Unisa page on the model, and there you can be able to access your question paper without being flagged out of app. And if the student are going to be using the laptop to type their answers and the invigilator app. So when the prompting comes, you can just simply take the pictures of your screen, your laptop screen as you are writing. And if you are writing it on the writing pad, you can just take the picture there on your page. I hope it's clear. I saw there were quite a few questions on that. Thank you, Lisa.
Thank you. Okay, so let's give our next speaker just 5 to 10 minutes to share with us. I don't know about everyone else here, you know, but I could imagine, you know, that dealing with all this information could be quite anxiety provoking. So let's just give Ms. Nalushi a chance for her to share some thoughts on exam anxiety with us. So if we can try to finish at 12:45, I would really appreciate that. Just in terms of any remaining questions that might not have been answered in the chat or during the presentation, please go and watch the presentation again if you didn't manage to attend the whole session. But also then you have the contact details. Somebody's microphone is open. Please just mute. So if you go and watch the presentation again, or you have any specific questions that weren't covered, Ms. Maneri shared the contact details, so please make use of that. And also the resources that were shared with you that's available on my Unisa. Thank you, Ms. Nalushi.
Thank you so much. Hopefully you will be able to see my presentation. Are you able to see it now?
Yeah, we're good to go. Thanks.
Okay. So now that we know all about how exams are going to go, I think it's very important to learn how to manage stress and anxiety during examination or to avoid it. The first thing that one needs to make sure of is eating healthy food. As much as, you know, you just take whatever is available and you eat, especially when you're under pressure, it's very important to eat food that is nutritious, and cut unhealthy food from your diet. Try to be as healthy as possible to reduce stress and anxiety and feeling anxious. There are certain foods that one would be would panic or feel anxious after eating. Some of us have, I'm one of those people who sweat, my hands sweat a lot. But if I eat spicy food or I eat oily food, I tend to become, I become excited and I become hyper. And that's not good for my hands because now I can't type properly or I can't use my laptop properly. I have to, you know, so yeah, just try to keep a healthy diet during exams. Sleep. Prioritize sleep. When we sleep, our body repairs itself. And this is when our body gets a chance to take a break from digestion. Our body washes itself and clears away debris, and our cells regenerate. If you sleep less than 6 hours a night, you are more likely to suffer from a heart attack or a stroke. You have to maintain a consistent bedtime routine. There are people who believe that they work better when they're under pressure, or they work better at night when they're not sleeping. But what you're doing to yourself is you're just making yourself sleep deprived, which makes you to function less, or you can't function optimally. So it's important to keep a consistent bedtime routine and avoid waiting for the last minute. Try to maintain a consistent sleep cycle. Because if not, then you may have cognitive deficits over time. So you might have issues like memory loss over time. And in the future, then when you're trying to get your PhD or your honors or whatever qualification that you're trying to get, you won't be able to remember the stuff that you studied, even if you studied really hard. Breathing, you can control your breathing. Although we cannot control some parts of our bodies, we can slow down and deepen our breath, thereby decreasing our heart rate and calming our mind. We have to oxygenate all our cells by moving air from our lungs to the rest of our body. You must do the breathing work every day before the exam if you feel anxious. And you should actually while you're writing your exam and you feel anxious, try to exercise. And here's a breathing exercise that you can do during your exam. I'm not going to speak much over it. You can take a screenshot. I'm just thinking of the time. I'm going to go to the next slide. Dinner or supper? I think this one is a tricky one because a lot of us, you'd find that maybe you're coming from work. If you have children, it even becomes more difficult because you have to help your children with whatever that you have to help them with. And you end up eating very late. And after eating, you sleep immediately, and that's not good for you. So try to keep, try to eat at least 2 to 4 hours before your bedtime. And this will give you enough time to digest the food before you sleep. Exfoliating your skin. This is another one that there's a myth that such things are only for women and not for men, but it's actually for everybody. So invest in a body scrub. A body scrub is a physical exfoliant that is used to remove dead skin cells from your skin so that your skin feels soft, supple, and nourished. It works by stimulating skin cells turnover for smoother, brighter skin and can help restore the skin's natural moisture. So there are different types of body scrubs, right? There are different ways of exfoliating. So one may not be able to afford a body scrub from one of these posh, these expensive skincare products. You can use bath salts also, and you can steam your face. This doesn't only improve the state of your skin, but it also keeps you confident because now you know that your skin looks good, it feels good, and you are more confident in also other areas of your life, including your academic life, which ultimately assists you during the exam. Movement. Any activity like running, swimming, hiking, or even taking a walk where your mind and body are linked in a safe place, it helps us. Physical exercise deepens sleep and improves mood. If you're a person who loves yoga, then do yoga. If you want to take a walk, take a walk. If you want to ride a bike, whatever it is, but you have to keep exercising. Otherwise, it's not good for your health. And now you're going to be nervous during the exam. Play. Joy, the expression of pure happiness, is a mere memory for most of us. A lot of us, I think if we could ask ourselves the question of when was the last time you played, especially if you're a busy person, a parent maybe, then you forget things like playing because you're so focused on getting things done. But if you have a child, play with your child. If you have siblings, play with your siblings. Play whatever you can play. Play video games. Play soccer if you're able to. This it brightens your mood and it allows you to feel happy during the exam season and you're not stressed too much about your exam. Staying informed. This, I think, is for me is one of the most important issues about writing exam and avoiding anxiety during the exam. You have to stay informed. If there's an event or a task that you have to do, such as an exam, staying informed, it allows you to be less anxious. So for example, if you don't know how to access the exam or if you don't know how to access the how to upload your answer sheet, then now you're panicking because you don't know where to upload or you don't know what to do. You could have done that earlier. You could have, like I think someone mentioned earlier that it's important to learn about these things prior to the exam. So it's important to stay informed. Try to check your announcements regularly on My Unisa. Check your My Life emails regularly and communicate with your lecturer if you are unsure about an issue concerning the module or the exam. Do not solely depend on Telegram or WhatsApp groups to gather information. Always double check using the official platforms that are provided by the university to verify information. So a lot of us, I know that we are on WhatsApp groups, we are on Telegram groups, but you have to verify with your lecturer or to verify with the university about especially exam information. For example, if you don't know what time the exam is starting, don't go to your WhatsApp group and find out the time of the exam. Go to your MyUNISA and find out from there. If there isn't information there, then ask your lecturer. Send your lecturer an email and find out. Go to the exam site and see what time your exam is at. See the date so that you are 100% sure, instead of relying on your classmates who could be actually telling you the exam date of another module that is not the same as yours. In that way, you avoid missing your exam, which has like big consequences. Read the instructions about the exam carefully and participate in mock examination if it's available. The other thing is you would be confused as to which, for example, which invigilating app to use. These are things that are available on the exam. You will see it on your exam on the site. There are instructions there as to how to go about your examination. Managing your time. Manage your time in such a manner that you don't have to wait for the last minute to figure out how to do things. This will give you time to calmly reflect on the content which you have learned throughout the semester. You will get a chance to prepare yourself mentally. So if you avoid trying to figure out things in the last minute, such as a way to upload the exam, then you will have time to think about the content, to reflect on what you have learned and what you're about to do. In that way, then you are more relaxed, you are more calm, and you don't have any, you're not panicking. You don't want to do things in the last minute, because even a minute counts. I think we've all been in a situation where you have so many questions that you haven't answered, but you only have 2 minutes. Now you're praying for a miracle to happen, and you know very well that there's no miracle that is going to happen. So in conclusion, these methods have assisted me to deal with stress and anxiety, choosing food that allows my body to feel energized and nourished, and I prioritize sleep, and I work on different exercises to activate my consciousness. Exercising does not only happen in the gym. You can take a walk, you can jog, you can skip. If you have a skipping rope, if you have children, take your child's skipping rope and skip. In that way, then you activate your consciousness and it boosts your confidence, because now you're feeling like, okay, I did that 1 kilometer run, or I skipped 200 times. I know what I'm doing and I'm capable. And in that way, you are able to feel confident even during your exam. I encourage or plead everyone to start incorporating these activities in order to deal with stress and anxiety during the exam period, especially this coming exam period. Thank you so much and good luck on your exam. I hope that we all know how to manage our anxiety. We try to incorporate whatever it is that you can do to stay confident. Confidence is very important during an exam, and I hope everyone takes it seriously, and good luck. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Short and sweet, but I think it covered all the important points. I've also shared a resource on the chat that you can use for further exam anxiety tips. I really want to thank our colleagues, Ms. Maneli, as well as Mr. Malautsi. We appreciate what you shared with us and also with students. From my side, I've learned quite a lot about all these different tools being used. And I do appreciate also the contact details so that we can inquire if we are stuck with anything in terms of the exams and the proctoring tools. So from my side, also thank you to our student mentors who presented this morning on exam preparation and exam anxiety. I hope that there were some tips that you can learn from them and start implementing. But I think all of us spoke about the importance of really starting to think about these things ahead of time, and it will really help you to prepare for the exams if you follow the different tips and advice that was given this morning. And then also a thank you to Mr. Vusumusipenyane for organizing the session. And we wish you all the best with the exams. I've also shared our contact details in the chat. So if at any stage you feel that you are quite overwhelmed and you need to have a conversation with one of the student counselors, please don't hesitate to contact us. And we wish you all the best for the examinations. Thank you very much.